In the name of God, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. I think most of you might agree that we've been through a difficult couple of years. With our concerns about COVID, the state of the nation, and the economy, we may be excused for forgetting the great tragedy the year before COVID of the fire that destroyed Notre Dame in Paris. Cleanup and restoration has been underway for 2 years now, and the architects have published plans for a new interior for the nearly 900-year-old treasure. The design has generated some controversy, as any plan would. The dark and little-used side chapels will gain new purpose as teaching spaces about the saints and Christianity's varying manifestations around the world. The design recognizes that most visitors to Notre Dame are not Christian and may not know the context or the symbolism of the worship space. The side chapels were a relatively recent addition, as historic spaces like Notre Dame are always changing over their long lives. If you have visited Notre Dame, you may recall that for the most part, the interior is pretty dark. The wonderful windows with light coming in from the outside are a high point for visitors. The new design is bathed in light, so the Gothic architecture will be more accessible to visitors and more welcoming. I'm looking forward to seeing the new interior. Seeing it alive with light after centuries of darkness will allow us a new sense of the sacred space that's been the heart of Paris for so long. And so this Sunday, with its rose candle and theme of rejoicing, allows us a glimpse of the coming light as we journey through the dark season of Advent together. Now, you might be excused if you feel some whiplash listening to today's lessons, from the joy of the first and second lessons to the anger of John. We begin with Zephaniah. Sing aloud, O daughter Zion, shout for joy. If this is all you read of Zephaniah, you could come away with the impression that Zephaniah is a prophet who speaks of joy and gladness. To balance that impression, you might read the rest of Zephaniah, which earns its prophecy the well-earned reputation as one of gloom and doom. The lectionary selects only the last oracle of Zephaniah with its exultation and rejoicing. We follow Zephaniah's rejoicing with the first song of Isaiah, ending with, "Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion, ring out your joy, for the Great One in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel." And we continue with the brief but familiar passage from Ephesians, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice." It's this passage that gives today its traditional name of Gaudete, which means rejoice. We light a rose-colored candle to heighten the emphasis on joy. And then we read Luke's account of John the Baptist at the River Jordan, and the sound of rejoicing is gone. John said to the crowds that came out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" The end of that selection concludes with, "And with many other exhortations, he proclaimed the good news to the people." This little bit of Luke captures so much of the rhythm of the Hebrew scriptures and of Advent. If we read more of Zephaniah, we encounter a series of oracles, beginning with prophecies of doom for the people of Israel. If they continue worshiping other gods, things will not go well for them. Then comes a plea for repentance and the joyful passages we read today. All of this is encapsulated in John, who preaches repentance just as the prophets of the Hebrew scriptures. To understand what John is calling people to repent of, listen to what he tells them to do. He tells them to bear the fruits of repentance. Share what you have with those who have nothing. Deal fairly with others. Do not exploit positions of power, but treat everyone well, especially those who have no power. By directing the crowds to do those things as repentance, we are to understand that they have not done those things. They have not shared what they have, that they have exploited their power, and that soldiers and tax collectors have stolen from others. I'm struck by John's warning to not rely on being children of Abraham. To us, it might be something like, do not rely on being good Episcopalians, that we will be judged not by who we are, but by what we do and how we treat those we live with or work with or encounter in our daily lives. The sins they are to repent of are sins we may also be guilty of abusing power, not sharing what we have with those who have little, of relying on who we are rather than what we do. God is able to raise up Episcopalians or even an archdeacon from the stones. Instead, we are to bear the fruits worthy of repentance. Our lives become the testimony to who we are as Christians. The crowds, probably stunned by John's indictment of them and his call to repent, ask who he is. Is John the promised Messiah? John responds by pointing us to the one who is to come, who is much greater than John, the one who is coming after him. If we put ourselves in the places of those who are hearing John, we might not know what to think of this prophecy of the one coming after him. We've known the Messiah is coming. We've known it all our lives. What is more urgent about John's preaching is that he knows that Jesus, the Christ, is already among them, not in some vague, distant future. He wants them to be ready to accept Jesus when he begins his ministry. The people likely have some idea about who the Messiah is and what he will be to them. But John wants them to be open to the unexpected, the Jesus who is really coming, not the worldly conqueror they may be anticipating. This Jesus who is really coming to them and to us brings hope and healing to the world through his love, not through his military power, not by conquering the Romans, but by offering unconditional love and acceptance. The prophet Isaiah tells us to prepare the way of the Lord by making the highways straight and smooth, leveling the mountains and raising the valleys. The prophet is not talking about physical roadways, though the Romans are pretty good at laying out straight highways. He's talking about removing obstacles in our hearts and minds. In the words of the carol, let every heart prepare him room. Make room for Christ's love. Allow times of silence for us to listen to the prophets, to John, and to Jesus. Jesus comes unexpectedly to us, unexpected in what he offers us and what he asks of us. He comes to us weak, a newborn child in poverty, and in a remote corner of the known world. In his ministry in Galilee and Judea, he walks with fishermen and tax collectors, healing the sick, speaking gently of love, and modeling how we should live out our lives. And this is all Jesus asks us to do. Jesus asks us to love one another, to care for the poor, heal the sick, and bring justice and peace to the world. We're not there yet. We are still awaiting Jesus and preparing our hearts. We're waiting for the light. For another 10 days or so, sunsets come earlier and the daylight is shorter. And then slowly, almost imperceptibly, the days begin to grow longer, Sunset comes a little later. The sun begins its migration north in the sky. Not yet, but we know the time is coming when we will see Christ among us, when we will welcome the infant Christ, God coming to us as a person, and we will sing with great joy, O come, Emmanuel. Amen.